Good morning. Many of you I know, or y'all know me, or anyway, Pastor Don Casper. This is my wife, Mary. Mary, raise your hand. Everybody say hi, Mary. It is our sixth month that we've spent down here at Fishers of Men. So we always enjoy coming down and feel blessed to be a part of your ministry here. Don has some things to share with us, and
thank you. All right, now we're cooking. I think that Sue's going to tell you something in a little bit about cooking, too, I think. This morning, first I want to welcome everybody here. How many people are here for February now that just arrived for the month of February? Okay, great. Welcome. You all missed a really good party last Sunday night. It was really, really good. It was our Come Follow Me kickoff campaign and Winter Texan Banquet, and it was really, really good. We had good music, good speakers. It was just really a good time, and time went by really fast. If you got an envelope this morning, it'll have a brochure in it that talks about extraordinary, and there's also a card in there that's a commitment card that if you would want to support what Fishers of Men is doing. Fishers of Men back a couple of years ago started having some meetings, and vision and planning meetings and stuff, and discussing whether what we were going to do because of the shrinking or declining attendance here at the church. And so we've decided that we are going to call a pastor if we can fund the pastor for the first 5 years, his compensation package. So that's what the Come Follow Me commitment campaign is. For those of you that didn't get one of these earlier in the year, we had a special brochure made out. We had a special voters meeting January 2nd, and that was the congregation, the voter assembly voted to proceed forward with calling a pastor. This kind of better explains, because both of these brochures, the one that came in your envelope, and this one kind of go hand in hand. So this one builds up to that one. If you don't have one of these, there's some of these at the back, and as you're leaving today, ask for those, okay? And I will, let's see if I need anything else. I think that's all that I need to say right now. Oh, I need to say something for Judy. See these? These were our nameplate, or what do you call them? Placemats, sorry. Until I'm a guy. We've got some of these left over, and Judy Lubin's got them. If you'd be interested in some of these, we're selling them right now to the leftover ones. If you want one, you could frame one if you don't want placemats. It's really cool. So anyway, Sue, do you want to say something?
Well, good morning and welcome to, I hope, a more beautiful day today. But I do have to tell you that we had our rummage sale yesterday, and thanks to all of you people here, it was a great success. And I want you to know the sale would be nothing if we didn't have the support of the workers that came all during the week faithfully. And it wouldn't be a success if it were not for those of you who came to buy and eat chili with us and enjoy the day with us. Even as cold as it was, you came out. And so my major announcement this morning is a big thank you. We really do appreciate it. The sale is going to be, at this point, we don't have it totally tabulated because we still have some sales that are out, but it will be at this point, our second largest rummage sale that we've had in 16 years, somewhere between $6,000 and $7,000. So, and I also want to let you know, after the service, we will be in the kitchen window back there if any of you would like to buy some take-home chili. And we have a few goodies left over from the bake sale, if you're interested. Remember, Super Bowl Sunday is next Sunday, and you're going to need chili. So it's back there. Take-home containers, $3 per container. Thank you.
Thank you, Sue. Okay, you got me back. I'm going to share a faith journey with you. It's not mine. It's someone else's that I worked with a few years ago and worked very closely with. And I'll explain this to you as we go. This faith journey is about a lady that her name is Brenda Segovia. And Brenda came from a broken home. She had a mom, a dad, a stepmom. Well, she had a dad, a stepmom, and she had a sister. And Brenda said her family background was Roman Catholic, but she said we didn't attend church, maybe sometimes at Christmas, maybe Easter. And in 2007, Brenda was a freshman. She was going to school out in San Jose, California. And one of her classmates came up and invited her to go with them to Disney World. And Brenda kind of wondered, you know, what's the catch? And they says, no, there's no catch. It's just free. And Brenda says, well, do I have to do anything? The classmate said, well, it's called the National Youth Gathering. And our church is sending a group of kids to Orlando. And so we're going to do car washes and do other things and raise money. And maybe you could come and help as we're trying to raise money. So Brenda joined this youth group and started coming with her girlfriend. And they started doing things. And as Brenda was going to these meetings, she was seeing people that during their youth group meetings, they were studying the Bible, they were playing games, they were singing songs, they were having fun building relationships. So Brenda really, really was enjoying this new church connection and her new church friends. So Brenda wanted to learn more about her church life. So at those youth group meetings, the kids all seemed to know a lot, and Brenda thought, well, man, I just got to learn. So she started attending worship services, and eventually Brenda wanted to be confirmed, and she became a member of that church. And Brenda's thirst for spiritual learning continued throughout her high school years, and when she graduated in 2011, Brenda went to Concordia University in Irvine, California. She enrolled in the Director of Christian Education curriculum. Brenda completed 4 years of her DCE training, and that was in 2015 when she was done with that. Then after you're done, you don't get to graduate. You have to go do a one-year internship. So Brenda did a one-year internship and got done with the internship, graduated in 2016. That fall of 2016, Brenda received a call to the Rio Grande Valley to come to serve at the Texas District Circuit 28 and the 12 congregations that are in Circuit 28. Fishers of Men is one of those 12 congregations. So Brenda got to work with our youth, and there's two larger congregations in Circuit 28. They're both called St. Paul. One's McAllen, one's Harlingen, and they're both large congregations. They both have DCEs. So their youth were getting to do something, but the rest of the congregations, the other 10 in the circuit, you know, we just got by with whatever we did. Well, Brenda brought a new life to the youth in our congregations, and you know, our youth really started growing from this, and they wanted to learn more. Fishers of Men has got a girl today, Jessica Baltazar. She's at Concordia University in Austin studying to be a DCE. She liked what she saw from our missionary pastors and the other pastors that we had here. She liked what she saw when Brenda was here working. Now, Brenda left just before COVID came. Brenda left us in October of 2019 on her third anniversary with us. She had a boyfriend that she'd met. She met a guy down here in the valley, but he wasn't from the valley. I think he was from Wisconsin. And he was working in Rio Hondo, working on a bridge. And he had been here for like 4 years on this bridge project the whole time Brenda was there, and they lived in the same apartment complex. He got another job and moved to Corpus to work on a bridge up there. And Brenda was going back and forth visiting him every 2 weeks, and she finally came and said, "Don, I just can't stand being away 2 weeks at a time." So I think a lot of us remember something like that. So anyway, Brenda resigned, and Brenda moved with her husband, or moved up to be by her boyfriend, and then they got married. And they've moved, and she's in Seattle, Washington right now. He's working on another bridge job. And Brenda's a DCE at another Lutheran church up there. So Brenda's faith journey happened, and it's still happening, because someone invited Brenda to come to church. Thank you, Pastor.
I'll share with you just a little bit what God has been doing in my life. Here, 6 or 8 weeks ago, I had a minor hernia surgery. Doctors, I said, "Well, you don't act like it's a big deal." He said, "Well, I do them all the time." Well, it wasn't so minor. I spent 9 days in the hospital. Took a while to recover. My intestines clogged up, and anyway. But what God was doing with me was teaching me how frail I am. And let me tell you, I was 1 week puppy. Mary was right there taking care of me all this time. And it reminded me, the reason I'm sharing that with you is that's why we're here this morning, okay? We are not in charge of our lives. We try to imagine that we are. But we're here this morning to say, God, you're our God. Jesus, you're the one we're trusting. We need your help. And then to hear him say, "I'm here to take care of you." We're going to open now with a hymn that says that very thing. That wonderful good news that God, our God, this morning and every day has his arms wide open to hug us, to take care of us, to help us in every way. We sing "Today Your Mercy Calls Us."
Thank you.
What else is there to say but amen, huh? What a beautiful hymn. As always, we begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
If you, O Lord, kept a record of our sins, O Lord, who could stand?
But with you there is forgiveness. Therefore you are feared.
Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in our thoughts, in our words, and in our deeds, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner.
Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Forgive us our sins and lead us to everlasting life. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his only Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
O God, be not far from me. O my God, make haste to help me. My mouth will tell of your righteous acts, of your deeds of salvation all the day, for their numbers pass by knowledge. With the mighty deeds of the Lord God, I will come. I will remind them of your righteousness, yours alone, O God. From my youth you have taught me, and I still proclaim your wondrous deeds. So even in old age and gray hairs, O God, do not forsake me until I proclaim your might to another generation and your power to all those to come. O God, be not far from me. O my God, make haste to help me. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you. We pray, O Lord, keep your family, the church, continually in the true faith. that relying on the hope of your heavenly grace, we may ever be defended by your mighty power. We pray this through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
We'll now have our readings from the life-giving, life-changing Word of God.
The Old Testament reading for today comes from the sixth chapter of Isaiah, beginning with the first verse. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, and two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And the foundation of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called. And the house was filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, for I am lost. For I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of people of unclean lips. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphim flew to him, having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth and said, "Behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for." And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" Then I said, "Here I am, send me." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We join together in Psalm 138. I give you thanks, O Lord, with my whole heart.
Before your eyes I sing your praise.
I bow down towards your holy temple and give thanks to your name for your steadfast love and your faithfulness.
For you have exalted
on the day I called, you answered me.
My strength of soul you increased.
All the kings of the earth shall give you thanks, O Lord.
For they have heard the words of your mouth.
And they shall sing of the ways of the Lord.
For great is the glory of the Lord.
For though the Lord is high,
hearing our hearts lowly, but the haughty he knows from afar.
Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve my life. The Lord will fulfill his purposes for me.
Your steadfast love, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the work of the Lord of your hands.
The epistle lesson for today comes from the 14th chapter of 1 Corinthians. Since you are eager for manifestations of the church, strive to excel in building up the church. Therefore, one who speaks in tongues should pray for the power to interpret. For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful. What am I to do? I will pray with my spirit, but I will pray with my mind also. I will also praise with my spirit, but I will sing with my mind also. Otherwise, if you give thanks with your spirit, how can anyone in the position of an outsider say, "Amen," to your thanksgiving when he does not know what you are saying? For you may be giving thanks well enough, but the other person is not being built up. Thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you. Nevertheless, in church, I would rather speak five words with my mind in order to instruct others than 10,000 words in a tongue. Brothers, do not be children in your thinking. Be infants in evil, but in your thinking be mature. This is the word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
to St. Luke, the 5th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
On one occasion, while the crowd was pressing in on Jesus to hear the word of God, Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, and he saw two boats by the lake, but the fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. Getting to one of the boats, which was Simon's, he asked him to put out a little from the land, and he sat down, and Jesus sat down and taught the people from the boat. And when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon Peter, "Put out into the deep and let your nets for a catch." And Simon answered, "Master, we've toiled all night and took nothing, but at your word I will let down the nets." And when they had done this, they enclosed a large number of fish, and their nets were breaking. They signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled both the boats so that they began to sink. And when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on you will be catching men." And when they brought their boats to the land, they left everything and followed him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
This morning we'll join together with Christians the world over to profess our faith with the Nicene Creed. Whenever I say the creed, I like to imagine Christians all over the world, as well as Christians who are already in heaven, standing together, united, and professing their faith in their God. Please join with me. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Please be seated. We'll now sing our sermon hymn. This is going to be our theme hymn for the whole month. Guide me, O thou great Redeemer.
Thank you.
now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O God, who art our strength and our redeemer. Amen. For the next four Sundays, the time I'm with you, or I should say the four Sundays of this month, I want to take you back 3,400 years, okay? 3,400 years, that's a long time ago. I want to take you back to a Bible story that I suspect that most of you are familiar with. I want to take you back to the Exodus story. But my dear friends, this will not simply be a history lesson about some ancient people. My purpose is, as we look at their Exodus, their travels from captivity to the promised land, that we will get a better understanding of our Exodus, our travels from captivity to the real promised land of heaven. As you probably remember, God's people, the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, whose name was changed to Israel when he fought with God. God's people, as we know them, were enslaved to the powerful king of Egypt. We know him as Pharaoh, don't we? He was a cruel despot. Enslaved them, worked them hard, used those people to build his buildings, his public buildings. They were enslaved for 400 years, you guys. We can't imagine that, can we? And they were without power to free themselves. And in their eyes, their situation seemed hopeless. And the Israelites, God's people, pleaded with God to help them. And the Lord Yahweh, being the gracious God he is and remembering his covenant with Abraham, heard their cry, and he spoke these words in Exodus chapter 3, verse 7. Can you put those on the screen now, Don? God's words. I've surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their cry. Because of their taskmasters, I know their suffering. And I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey. It's God's plan. He says, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to save my people. And to do that, he chose a man named Moses. You know that name also. He chose Moses and planned to send him to save his people from Egypt. He chose Moses to be the one who would lead them through the wilderness to the promised land of Canaan. And so God, in talking with Moses, said, Moses, I'm going to use you. I got to use you for this. And Moses, you know, I'll use my vernacular, but that said, well, what is it you want me to do, God? You know, what is it you want me to do? He said, well, I want you to go to Egypt, and I want you to go up to the palace where the king is, that the mighty Pharaoh. By the way, Egypt is the most powerful nation on the face of the earth at that time, okay? This is the most powerful man on the face of the earth, not known for his good deeds either, for being a Mr. Nice Guy. And God said, now, Moses, I want you to go up there to the palace in Egypt, and I want you to tell Pharaoh that he is to let my people go. Well, Moses didn't cotton to that idea very much. And if you remember, he came up with excuse after excuse, three different excuses. And God answered every one of his excuses. And finally, Moses said, okay, I'll go and confront Pharaoh. You probably know the story of Moses confronting Pharaoh. How God used him to send 9 plagues upon that land of Egypt. Frogs and gnats and darkness and hail. But the king of Egypt, the Pharaoh, despite the devastation that the plagues brought upon his nation, upon his people, refused to obey the hand of God. But God said, I've got one more plague, a tenth plague, and this time Pharaoh will understand and will let my people go. What God told Moses is, I'm going to send the angel of death over the land. And the angel of death is going to kill the firstborn of every family in Egypt. But the Lord provided a way for the Israelites to be spared from that angel of death. It was called the Passover meal. As a part of that Passover meal, after they had killed a lamb, they were to catch the blood and then they were to sprinkle it on the door frames of their homes, okay? On the doorpost and on the top rail of their homes, the doors of their homes. And God promised that every family that had the blood of the lamb on their doorpost, the angel of death would pass over them. It gets its name, the Passover meal. The angel of death would pass over those blood-covered homes. And the angel of death went through that land. Horrible devastation. Can you imagine every family in Egypt having their firstborn son killed? After that angel of death flew over and slaughtered the firstborn of every family in Egypt, and even slaughtered Pharaoh's firstborn son, Pharaoh relented, he consented, and he told Moses that the Israelites, that he was free to take the Israelites out of the country. He was free for Moses to lead them out of his country and lead them through the wilderness to the promised land. Hopefully, my little short, concise summary of those events is correct. Your homework assignment is to read Exodus chapter 7 through 12. You will be blessed if you do. Exodus 7, verse 12. That's the Old Testament story. But what's this got to do with me and you? Here in Texas, in the start of this new year. My friends, hopefully you've already begun to see this as a picture. The more proper word is a type. See this as a picture of a far greater Exodus, our Exodus, okay? The word Exodus just means, it's from Greek ex, hodos, way out. Ex is out, hodos is way. This is a picture of our way out of captivity. So what I'd like to do, it's to think through that Old Testament Exodus, at least the part of it that we've looked at, and so that we might better understand our life here in this world. Like the Israelites of old, we were enslaved to a cruel dictator. Enslaved, y'all. Bound. Enslaved to a cruel dictator. Not a man, but Satan, a spiritual power, the second most powerful force in the world. We were not bound to him for a mere 400 years like the Israelites of old. No, we were bound and condemned to be with him in hell for all eternity. Like the Israelites of old, when we look at only our powers, our abilities, our situation appears hopeless. And we cry out to God, help us. Help us. Help us get away from this devil, this Satan. let me, in response to our plea, let me give you the Casper paraphrase of Exodus chapter 3, verse 7. Can you put that up on the screen now? Our God, remembering the covenant that he made with Abraham and renewed with you and I at our baptism, said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in bondage to the devil and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. I know their suffering and have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the devil and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey. That's God's promise. And to save us, he chose another Savior, not Moses. He chose a Savior far greater than Moses, far greater than any mere human being. He chose his only Son, Jesus, which, by the way, means Yahweh saves. And our Savior, Jesus, left the glory of heaven, where he's worshiped and adored by all. He left there and came down into this sin-filled, sin-corrupted world for one purpose, so he could save you and me from slavery, eternal slavery and bondage to the devil. And in contrast to Moses, Jesus was not reluctant to confront the one who enslaved us. No, he volunteered. And he came willingly to this earth. He came willingly in love because he loves you so much. Even though he knew it meant the ultimate sacrifice. My dear friends, we are not saved from the true angel of death by the blood of a baby sheep sprinkled on the doorpost of our houses like the Israelites of old. No, we are saved from eternal death by the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ. By him shedding his blood on the cross, and that blood is sprinkled on the doorpost of our hearts, not the doorpost of our homes. That blood that is sprinkled on us is the blood that flowed from his wounds as he experienced that hell cross. That's the punishment we deserve, y'all. We deserve, by all rights, we deserve to spend eternity in hell. And Jesus said, no, I'll go to hell for them. And he went to that cross so that he might sprinkle his blood on us. Sprinkle his blood on us, not in the Passover meal like the Israelites of old, but sprinkle his blood on us in the sacrament of holy baptism and sacrament of holy communion. My dear friends, like the Israelites of old, in faith, covered by the blood of the Lamb, the angel of death has passed over us. What a picture, the angel of death passing over. As I kneel to take communion today, you may see me smiling. It's not unusual for me when I take communion to think about that very picture, that the blood of Jesus covers all my sins and the angel of death has passed over me. You can't help but smile when you think about that, that Jesus would do that for me. Now we are covered by the blood of the Lamb and protected from eternal death. Now we have been freed by Jesus from captivity to Satan. We've been freed from the fear of death. And now, we are headed to the promised land with Jesus. Maybe sooner than we think, huh? We're not there yet. We're not there yet. But trusting our Savior Jesus, we will get there one day. Oh, what a glorious day it's going to be. Now with Jesus leading us, we are traveling through the wilderness of this life. And as you know, the wilderness journey can be tough, can it? We're not in heaven yet. But with Jesus, we're safe and secure, with Him leading us, with Him taking care of us. I invite you to come back for the next three Sundays. We're going to learn more about our exodus through this the wilderness of this life, as we look at other parts of the Exodus story in the Bible. I also invite you to come and join us for Bible class. It gives us more time to delve into this awesome type where we learn so much about our journey with Jesus to heaven. God, help us to be faithful to Him as we follow Jesus, our Savior, the one who has freed us, as we follow Him to heaven, the promised land. Amen and amen. Now let us sing again, "Guide Me, O Thou Great Redeemer." Go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, what a gracious and merciful God you are. How good it is to be reminded that you have redeemed us through the suffering and death of your Son Jesus, that we are your forgiven children, and now you're leading us to heaven. So our prayer, Lord, is help us to be faithful. Help us to follow your guidance as we look forward to that day when we cross the Jordan River and enter the true promised land. Father, we pray for all those who are under persecution, all those who are hurting, those who have physical ailments, those who are grieving. We just lift them up to your loving care. We pray for all of our military personnel, We think of those that in Syria and other parts of the world. Lord, be with them in a special way. Draw close to them and protect them and take care of them and fill them with a keen awareness that they are protecting us as a nation and protecting our neighbors. They're being used by you. Be with your church worldwide. Again, especially where the church is under persecution, bless their efforts. Be with us here at Fishers of Men. Bless all of our efforts. You blessed us for these 30 years and you've used us. We ask that you continue to do so. Bond us together and use us even more. And Lord, we pray that it's your will that we get a full-time pastor. And so bless those efforts. If that be your will, bless our efforts to get one. Bless our families. Protect them from Satan. Be with our nation, especially our leaders. We lift them up to your loving care. We pray that you would give them wisdom to lead this nation in a God-pleasing way. And today, nourished by your precious word in this divine service, help us go forth to faithfully serve you during this coming week. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior. Amen and amen. Now we continue with the service of the sacrament. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him our sin, giving him into death that we might not die eternally. Because he is now risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death and will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, for you have had mercy on us and given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. As the glory of your presence once filled the ancient temple, so in the incarnation of your Son, Jesus Christ, you manifested the fullness of your glory in human flesh. We give you thanks that in his most holy supper, you will reveal your glory to us. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood, so that we may one day behold your glory face to face. Hear us as we pray in his name, and as he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to them and said, take and eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And then, in the same way, after supper, he took the cup. And when he gave them thanks, he gave it to them and said, drink ye all of it. This cup is the new testament in my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. We will now celebrate the Lord's Supper. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Which way are they going? Huh? Oh. Susan, take and eat. This is the very body of Jesus Christ, your Lord.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your power of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge, strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I'll love you, forever.
May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and preserve you in body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. Pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we pray you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith towards you and in fervent love towards one another. We pray this through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
And
now receive the benediction which God, during the Exodus journey, commanded Moses to have spoken over the people. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace.
Amen.
We close by singing that great hymn, Go My Children with My Blessing.
Thank you.
seated for a moment. Dale has something he wanted to share with us.
All glory and peace and blessings to our Lord Jesus Christ, for without whom I couldn't be showing you this plaque this morning. And this is just from our banquet. We started out with the donation of $50,000. From the banquet, we received an additional $48,280. And we have matching funds. It started out at $150,000. We have a balance left of approximately $102,000. So after 1 week, we're at $146,560. That's a tremendous accomplishment. Without God, that would not have been possible. Thank you, Jesus. And thank you all for your gifts. And we invite the new Winter Texans that are here to look at the literature that Don presented and pray about it. We certainly prayed as a congregation for God to lead us to calling this new pastor. And the pastor we'll call will be bilingual, and he will be filled with the Spirit for evangelism. We ask you to pray about your commitment. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dale. Any other quick announcements? Time is running. As we journey through the wilderness of sin to the promised land of heaven, as I say all the time, hang on to Jesus for dear life.